Hello, everyone, and welcome to this discussion that I'm having with Deborah Parks. The name of our discussion today is Life Sentences, a Feminist Abolitionist Perspective. And before we begin, and before I introduce Deborah, I wanted to just do a quick land acknowledgement and an introduction of who I am, and then we'll get into the meat of the discussion. Thank you for being with us, Deborah, so bear with me for a moment. Everyone, my name is Emily Coyle. I'm the executive director of the Canadian Association of Elizabeth Fry Societies. Our main office is in the traditional and unceded territory of the Algonquin Nation, which is colonially known to many as Ottawa, Ontario. Algonquin territory remains home to many First Nations, Inuit, and Métis peoples from across Turtle Island. And while our main office is located in this territory, our work is done across the country. And so our work takes place on the traditional territories of many different nations. Many within the CAFES network are white from European settler ancestry. And some of us have come to these lands through other histories of colonialism, which are rooted in slavery and forced migration. There are also many of us who are Indigenous to Turtle Island, and every day we work to acknowledge our relationship to this land and to colonialism, and to work in solidarity with Indigenous people toward decolonization, especially by paying critical attention to the ways that our work environments continue to reproduce colonial logics. The connection between colonization and the criminalization of Indigenous people is irrefutable and has led to a crisis of over-incarceration and disproportionate punishment for Indigenous women and gender diverse people. The path forward to stopping this crisis must address the root causes and put Indigenous self-determination at the center of any and all solutions. We echo the demands from Indigenous communities to the Canadian government to implement the calls to action from the reports released by the National Inquiry into Missing and Murdered Indigenous Women and Girls, the Royal Commission on Aboriginal Peoples, and the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. So Deborah Parks, thank you for joining us. Deborah, who is joining us today, is a professor and chair in feminist legal studies at the Peter Allard School of Law at the University of British Columbia. And I'm really, really pleased to be speaking with you today, Deborah. I think you have so much that is going to bring people's thoughts and perspectives into a whole other arena as we go through this. So thank you for joining us. Would you also like to tell us where you're joining from today?
Yes, thank you, Emily. It's terrific to be joining you virtually. And this is one of the benefits of being able to connect in these ways that I can participate in this conversation with you. I'm joining you today from the traditional, ancestral, and unceded territory of the Coast Salish peoples. I live in what is now called New Westminster on the shores of the Stolo, the Fraser River. And it is also the home of the Kakite First Nation, which is a landless designated as a landless Indian band under the Indian Act and has been entirely dispossessed of even a land base. I teach at UBC, which is on the territory of the Musqueam people, but in and around these areas, there's a number of other Coast Salish peoples whose lands that I am privileged to be an uninvited but grateful guest on. And this area is also, and those lands of the Katsikikwitlam and other First Nations out in the what is now the Stolo or the Fraser Valley is the place where there's many incarcerated people. It's one of those areas in Canada where there's a real concentration of incarceration. And it's sort of palpable. It's a part of the economy of the area near where I live, and I also live very close to where the BC Penitentiary used to be. It's like a 5-minute walk from where I am, and there's a cemetery there, and a number of us go and pay our respects to the people, the many people who have died in places of incarceration. And I say all that to just to locate in as part of a land acknowledgement, the ways that colonialism and colonial laws have marked these lands and created these institutions of incarceration that are very much a continuation of the colonial project. And for those of us who work in and through law, thinking about the ways that law has been used to perpetuate the colonial logics and colonial harms and the harms of incarceration. So I'm really delighted to be able to be in conversation with you, Emily, and to hear that approach that CAFES is taking. And it's very consistent with the approach that I also take to this work. So thank you for that.
Well, let's get into our conversation. I think one of the leading questions that we have for you is, why are life sentences an important issue? It's a big question, and I'm hoping you can help us to dissect it.
Yeah, thank you. And, you know, just as a starting place, there's over 5,000 people in Canada who are living under a life sentence right now. And that is over 20% of the population of people who are under a federal sentence. So that's a lot of people. And the other thing that I think we need to really bear in mind is that these are life sentences. And I know that's like, well, yeah, of course they're life sentences, but these are sentences that follow a person for their entire life. So if they are sentenced as a 19-year-old, and they spend a certain number of years, and we'll talk about the periods of time people spend in prison. They then, when they are 40, 50, 60, 70 years old, they are still under that life sentence. And that may sound like, well, that's, you know, you do the crime, you do the time, and we talk about, you know, that's sort of the vast majority of people are serving a sentence for murder, which is the most serious offense that we have in our law. But there's really often no relationship between the goals of sentencing, the purported goals of sentencing, which include, deterrence, rehabilitation, denunciation. There's a range of purposes in the criminal code. And even if you accept those at face value, and I don't actually, I'll say that I have a lot of, I don't believe that actually those principles are actually what motivates our sentencing. It's very much a pure punishment in many ways. And those other sentencing principles are often, in my view, a kind of window dressing on a whole regime which is meant to exclude and consider people disposable and cast them out of our society. But even accepting those principles at their face value, they're just not, these sentences just, you know, are wildly in many cases overshooting the mark and putting all kinds of resources into monitoring people for their entire lives and returning people to prison in cases where there's no real public safety rationale for that, and certainly not the original one, which is around punishment for the most serious crime of murder. And so I think we could, and in our conversation, I hope we're going to dig into, you know, some of the details of that, but just as a kind of primary point, these are sentences that, you know, that we mete out in very significant ways in Canada, and we, you know, we think of our legal system as potentially, you know, maybe more humane, human rights based, and yet if you look internationally, life sentences are not, you know, it's not the case that every jurisdiction uses life sentences, even for, you know, the most serious offenses. In Portugal, for example, life sentences are unconstitutional. They're not a permitted sentence. In other jurisdictions, they have been abolished and are not used. And those are still jurisdictions that use imprisonment, but they just use it in a more restrained and limited way than we do. And I think Canadians need to face up to the way that we actually are very punitive. We often compare ourselves to the US, and that's sort of an easy comparison. US is an extreme outlier in terms of being, massively more punitive than other comparable, countries to which we normally compare ourselves in terms of, systems of, that have a democratic base and that purport to uphold principles of human rights and even to kind of basic liberal principles. And but comparing ourselves to anyone else, Canada doesn't stand up that well, in my view, and in my kind of research on this. We're quite punitive, and I think we need to reckon with that and decide whether we're okay with what is being done in our name, with our resources, and to our community members.
I think a lot of people will be very surprised, because Canadians like to think of ourselves as advanced and a just country, one that respects human rights. And I am curious about the history of life sentences in Canada. Have we always been like this? How have life sentences changed over time in Canada, in our laws?
Yeah, thank you. For that, and they have changed significantly, and this is some research that I'm doing with some colleagues right now. But one of the things that is important to understand is the regime that we have. So when I say that people, those 5,000 people are serving life sentences, that's the vast majority of those are serving that sentence for murder, where life is a mandatory sentence. Everybody, every single person who's convicted of murder in Canada since 1976 has got a life sentence, because 1976 is when we abolished capital punishment. And when we abolished capital punishment, it was a free vote in Parliament. You had massive debate going on in our society and kind of reckoning with this punishment that we had used, that we had in our laws as the most serious punishment for the offense of murder. And a decision to say that sentence was not going to be used anymore, but that we would substitute for that what we used to have capital punishment. And most people weren't being executed and weren't getting, even people who'd been sentenced to death weren't being executed. So those sentences had been mostly commuted to life in any event, but we still had capital punishment on the books. And when we, in 1976, when we got rid of that, the trade-off was to say, we were gonna bring in a really harsh regime. And this was recognized as a really harsh regime internationally, to say that everybody was gonna get a life sentence, and that everybody would get a life sentence, and the judge would be able to set a parole eligibility period between at least, they had to serve at least 10 years in prison, and the judge could set it between 10 and 25 years for everyone convicted of murder, and that would be a decision that the judge would make. And then if it was so-called first degree murder, which is more sort of aggravated forms of murder, where killing of a police officer or killing that are planned and deliberate or some other ways that make it seen as more serious, then the minimum parole ineligibility period is 25 years. And so as part of that, this was, I really understood it, and I've read the debates, and politicians across the political spectrum understood that this was a very serious and really harsh sentence. And one of the things that was kind of a deal breaker or crucial to that regime was a provision that provided for judicial review after 15 years for people who got that 25-year parole ineligibility, or anybody who got more than 15 years parole ineligibility, either a longer parole ineligibility period for second-degree murder or everyone who had a first-degree murder sentence. And for those people, we had this so-called faint hope clause, you may have heard of, where you would go before a jury of your peers, of Canadians, who would agree, who would hear all the evidence of what the offense was, what had happened to you, and what you had done in the interim years, and whether they should consider reducing your parole ineligibility period. And again, that's not a decision for you to get parole, just to be able to go before the parole board, who would decide. In 76, when we brought in this regime, we made the decision that there was two layers. There was the judge deciding what the parole eligibility period was, and then everybody would have to still go before the parole board to decide whether they could be released. And the parole board has always had as their mandate and their fundamental consideration, public safety. And so they take quite a, I would say, risk-averse approach to that role and to that decision-making, meaning that they have to be satisfied that the person, should be released and can be released safely into the community. And there's a lot of other research we could talk about with respect to parole, and I'll talk a little bit about some of that later. But basically, so we had, that was the regime. And this is a long answer to your question, but let me get to it, what's happened between them. So since then, what's happened is we have abolished the faint hope clause, those judicial review proceedings. And what we know about, and that happened in 2011, this was during the Harper decade of 10 years of Stephen Harper being Prime Minister of Canada, and there being a number of legislative changes that made our murder sentencing law more punitive. That's one of them, getting rid of that prospectively. So for anyone whose offense was after 2011, they don't have the benefit of the faint hope clause. And interestingly enough, if you look at the research on that, and I can send a link to it, not everybody goes up for faint hope clause when faint hope hearing when they're eligible for it, a judicial review proceeding. There's people who are sort of self-selected and weed out and don't actually go forward. But the ones who do go forward have been quite successful. And what that shows us is that ordinary Canadians, when they actually are faced with a real person and not a myth and not a media soundbite, but a real person who did something or they're convicted of doing something that was the worst thing that, you know, that they've done or that we could think of someone doing, and a person died. And yet we recognize, and Canadians, regular people who sit on those juries, have recognized that actually, I think this person should have a chance at going for parole because, you know, look at the work that they've done or what changes have happened in their life and just whether or not the 18-year-old that they were at that time. And we can never replace a life that was taken. We can, you know, as a society, like that is something that is, you know, I don't want to ever be seen as diminishing the fact that you know, someone's life is taken. It is, you know, it's horrible, and it's obviously just something that can't be repaired. And we, as a society, have to figure out how we, you know, address that kind of harm. But what we're doing now is, is imposing this punishment. And even with, the kind of prevailing views that we have as a punishment-based system, we still have a majority of those people who go before those juries, the juries finding that, in fact, they should have a chance at parole earlier than the 25 years. And that to me is really interesting and speaks to the kind of mismatch between our policies and what people actually will think when they actually come face to face to what these laws mean on the ground and what it might mean to just warehouse someone for an additional 10 years at great cost, fiscal cost, but also great personal cost to communities and families and, you know, all of us really. So we changed that. We abolished that. We also made it possible for people in 2011 to get consecutive periods of parole ineligibility. And so this has been in the news lately with an appeal at the Supreme Court of Canada in the Bissonnette case. And that's for first degree murder where the court is considering whether it's constitutional to allow a judge to so-called stack parole ineligibility periods on one another and to give someone a 50-year or 75-year or 100-year parole ineligibility period if there were more than one person who died as a result of the offense. And so in any event, we've made it more punitive in that way. But the thing that I'm really interested in is the ways in which through our judicial system and the parole system and the correctional system, our laws have, our murder sentences have become longer and more punitive. And that's not through any explicit change in policy. It's just through a ratcheting up of these parole ineligibility periods. I did a study with, I'm going to shout out to my my colleagues, Professor Jane Sprott at Ryerson and Professor Isabel Grant, or actually it's Metropolitan Toronto University now, and Isabel Grant here with me at UBC. And we studied recently the kind of 4 years of data on how long people are getting for their parole ineligibility, what periods judges are setting, and then how long, when people get those parole ineligibility periods, how long they're spending in prison before being released. Like, are they getting released at their 10-year mark, or are they getting released, you know, at their 15-year mark, 5 years later? And what we found, unfortunately, is that, and well, it's unfortunate in my view, because I think we're not even, our laws are not even really consistent with what they were, and at a time when murder rates and crime rates are going down, we have our sentencing rates and time people are spending in prison going up. And so, you know, I have a paper that we can link in the notes to this about how we found that, for example, in those early years after 76, the first 15 years, most people would get 10 years. Judges, over 50% of judges would order the 10-year period. And now, in the most recent decade that we looked at, it's 15% of people get the 10 years. So it's just a ratcheting up. And then, you know, we have more people getting over 15 years and over 20 years as their parole ineligibility. So we're just finding people getting longer parole ineligibility periods. And then what we also found is in those early days, it used to be that over 42% of people, I know a lot of stats here, but 42% of people would get released within 1 year of their parole eligibility date who were life sentenced for murder. Now it is down to 15% again, right? So what we're finding is that we have people spending 5 years, that 5 years is becoming the norm, 4 and 5 years for many people. And some are never released, of course, but just that these numbers are going up on all fronts. And I think this is something for us to reckon with.
It's true. You know, there's what people have noticed in prison is that they, and are telling each other, you know, if you have a life sentence, you're not going to get parole when you first try, and even within your first year. So, you know, so don't even try. You're not going to get it. And, you know, we at CAFES, we go into the prisons, we monitor conditions of confinement, and we're particularly interested in people's human rights and whether or not their rights are being upheld in prison. And part of that is, you know, our laws set parole eligibility for a reason. And so if you are eligible for parole, you should be able to have a fighting chance when you go before the parole board at your earliest possible release date. And it is frustrating when we encounter people who've been in the prison for years past their parole date. And, you know, you've just written a really great book chapter that talks about why feminists should think about life sentences, why life sentences is a feminist issue. And in that chapter, you talked a lot about who the people are that get these life sentences. And so, you know, I'd like you to go into that a little bit, and then I can tell you a little anecdote afterward. But who are the people who are getting sentenced to life in Canada?
Yeah, no, that's a really, that's an important part of this picture. And when you look at the numbers, and these are just the government's own numbers that you can find on, you know, the statistical, correctional statistical overview every year, is that Indigenous people are vastly, you know, I mean, say overrepresented. Should be no representation in this, but like it's massively incarcerated for life sentences. Indigenous women, if you look at the numbers of people who are admitted on a life sentence, looking in the last decade alone, I've got the numbers here, but it is that it was I think I found calculated 45% of the women who have been admitted for life sentences in the last 10 years are Indigenous women. If you break down some of those years, in some of the years, it's like half of the women who are coming in on life sentences are Indigenous women. So, you know, when you talk about the, you know, the report Missing and Murdered Indigenous Women and Girls, you know, you talk about the way that that our society does not provide meaningful protection to Indigenous women who experience extraordinary levels of violence, colonial violence, and, you know, interpersonal violence, state violence, and that the their acts of protection and resistance and self-preservation are often really criminalized. And that is across the spectrum of offenses that we have, but we see it in really extreme ways with respect to murder. But the other thing about that, so I think we really need to center those the people who are convicted of these most serious offenses and are thinking around our laws and what kind of a legal regime do we think you know, we need to have. You know, what you're talking at the beginning about looking to Indigenous legal orders for, you know, very different ways of dealing with harm in our communities. And I think that's important to be really looking to. And what we often do, I think, unfortunately, in our thinking around even like sort of decarceration and even policy change to reduce, for example, get rid of mandatory minimum sentences or to which are all things that I very much support, we often carve murder out as the thing that we don't want to deal with, and we carve life sentences out of that. But I think we can't do that. And I think we shouldn't do that. And I think instead, in that piece that I wrote, I talked about actually starting there and saying, what if we actually start with the people who are convicted of these most serious offenses? And we sort of center them, and we understand, we try to look at what, you know, what it looks like, you know, what that experience looks like, and what we are now doing as a society to kind of pile on to that experience and to make it, you know, kind of worse for all of us. You know, we often want to carve out those people and say that they're the exceptions. We'll leave them to the end. But I actually think that when you actually meet people who are living under life sentences, who have been convicted for murder, you find that they are people who you have sometimes a lot in common with, and when you actually hear their story, you can understand, and you can not say, you know, that's fine, or somehow we're not gonna think of this as something that we should address in our society and we try to prevent. But if we actually meaningfully care about that, we do very different things than just simply throw those people into places of incarceration. And we talk about locking up and throwing away the key, and that's a cliche, but the reality is, with people who are serving life sentences, they are under those sentences for their lives. And I think it's not serving anyone to just simply say, we're going to leave that to another day. We're just going to focus on these other offenses. And we're just going to, because I think if we leave that for another day, we are accepting the logic of punishment, exclusion, and really kind of long-term exile, you know, as a fundamental thing that we're okay with. And I guess I'm not okay with it. The more that I've met people who are living under these sentences, and I have looked at what we're doing, you know, I'm not okay with it. And a lot of people I talk to are also not okay with it. So I think we can start there and think about doing things, I think, quite differently.
Well, so that I'm going to skip ahead a couple of questions, because I think I am really curious now to know why and how you became involved in legal or scholarly advocacy about life sentences. What brought you to this? I mean, you say you care a lot about it. So what, why, how did this happen?
You know, so when I, how I actually got involved in any of this work around incarceration and thinking about our laws and sort of questioning them was when I was in law school, which is, you know, quite a long time ago now, and I took Michael Jackson's penal policy course at UBC, which I now teach a version of that course. And that's kind of one of those amazing experiences to come sort of full circle and to be now in a position to be teaching that class. But I was very interested in the experiences of women who were in prison. And Michael's class tended to focus, he does most of his work in the men's prisons. And so we actually went in to one of the men's prisons out in the valley here. And, you know, I met with some folks who were incarcerated, and I learned a lot from that experience, had lots of questions and lots of, you know, lots of just learning from that. But I wanted to hear about what was happening with women. And this is back in the late 90s. And at that time, mid 96. And at that time, women who were designated MACs in the federal system were being incarcerated in segregated units inside the men's prisons, because that was before the multi-level regional prisons had the MACs capability that was subsequently built, to our great shame, I would say, and detriment, to have fortified those prisons that were meant to be, you know, on a much more open and community moving in and out of them and all kinds of things that never really happened after the so-called, after the Creating Choices report and the regional prisons were built. But in any event, I got to fly out to Saskatoon, went up to Prince Albert and met with two women who were living under life sentences at the time in a segregated unit inside a MACS prison, two women on their own. And that was a formative experience, meeting those women and hearing about their experience. And then I've sort of followed, one of those women has passed away. Another of those women is finally in the community. But, you know, honestly, seeing and meeting people who were living under life sentences in the kinds of the way that our system was treating them, I just had like tons of questions about that. It just didn't seem right. And I subsequently did work for CAFES as a researcher, as a student. I was on the CAFES board. I started doing research in this area as an academic in the early 2000s. And I was on the board of the Manitoba Elizabeth Fry Society and chair of that board for a while. And in that capacity, I met someone who became a friend, a good friend at the time, who was working for the organization and who had been, who was living under a life sentence. She had been successful in one of those judicial review proceedings that I talked about, where she had a murder conviction, a first degree murder conviction from the time she was 18 years old. And she had her parole ineligibility period reduced, and she was released around 17 years and by the parole board. And she was doing really well in the community. She was married to someone who was also living under a life sentence and on parole. And, you know, and my family visited with them, and I knew them very well. And, you know, she struggled with, you know, some mental health issues, some depression, that really was all conditions that she developed by being incarcerated and being in the kinds of conditions that she was in for that formative period of her life. And she was, her parole was suspended, and she was brought back into the remand center, really for nothing that was a threat to public safety. This is very common, and you will hear about this, Emily, in your work. Women, men, trans people, various people who are living under life sentences or any kind of parole, frankly. But when you talk about life sentences, if you have your parole suspended, you're now in for, you know, for years and years. And in her case, she was brought back into the remand center. She was did move out to a halfway house. At one point, we were working, some of us were working to try to get her out on a habeas corpus because we believed it was an unlawful detention that she was under, and she died by suicide and while still in the halfway house. And that's someone who is, that made a huge impact in my life, seeing just the deep injustice in how she was sent back to prison, really for something. And this is the thing that I want people to understand. people are sent back to prison on life sentences for all kinds of things that are totally lawful for those of us who are not living under those sentences to do. To have a glass of wine, to meet with someone, to just be in the same place with someone who they have a condition not to be in the same place with, to do anything that the parole officer decides is creating some kind of risk. And it's very broad, that discretion that parole officers have. And it is exercised in ways that mean that people can be revoked and sent back to prison for really the simplest of things. And so, you know, the numbers, I don't have it in front of me right now, but the numbers are very low for people being returned for new offenses. It's for breaches of conditions if they are returned. And you know, extremely low for breaches for commission of new violent offenses. I think for people who are under life sentences, the last stats, again, government stats, were that it was 0.5% were returned for a violent offense. And so, you know, who had been released on day parole. And so, you know, it's just, this system is meant to keep people under perpetual punishment, to keep people under state surveillance when there's no longer any real public safety or other justification for that. And so, having met people, and the woman I spoke with is just one of those people who I've met who are living under life sentences. Others who I see, you know, have been out for some period of time, but still can't, you know, can't go from BC to Alberta with, or can't go home to visit community, can't even go a few, actually closer than that, to visit family members without getting, explicit permission and, you know, really, you know, having to deal with really quite incredible surveillance and strings on their lives. And I just think this is not serving any of us. It's just, but what it is doing is making sure people know that our society is going to perpetually punish them. And I think that's the message that's sent by that. It's not anything that we need to do to protect people or to alleviate harms, really. It's a pure kind of punishment and surveillance system. And I guess I would say that I really want us to rethink that and to be, you know, to kind of decide whether we're okay with that and whether this is something that we might want to revisit collectively.
And so your scholarly work is engaged with asking those important questions, asking people to engage with those assumptions that we're making about people and assumptions that we make about our justice system being just. Certainly, I now work with and know a few people who are serving life sentences, and the way that they are controlled by community corrections is something that we don't talk about a lot, because we talk a lot about prisons and prison abolition and the harm that prisons meet on people in their prison time. But for those people who are serving life sentences, community corrections is something that continues to hold them and keep them from living full lives. And I agree with you. You know, for those of us who care very much about how we treat each other and what our systems say about human dignity and how we should be caring for one another, life sentences are extremely important part of that conversation, because if someone is constantly living in fear that, you know, something that has now become legal in Canada, which is cannabis, being with someone who has cannabis or perhaps having cannabis in their possession now could send them back to prison is, you know, should no longer be something that we, are punishing. And yet there are people who continue to be punished by those. So I think it's an important conversation that you're bringing to the attention of, you know, both academia, but also into the greater public narrative. So I want to thank you for that. And I wonder if you could tell us, you know, we started talking a little bit about who is serving a life sentence in Canada, who are the people that are being overly punished by being sentenced to these life sentences, but what do most people not know? Is there anything else that most people wouldn't know about life sentences that they should know? Again, we've already talked a little bit about what happens when they're on parole, but is there anything else that you wanted to bring to our attention?
One thing I had meant to actually say before, and I forgot at the beginning, was I don't know that people know that we actually sentence young people, children, to life. This is something that that Canada does. We have provisions in our criminal law that if a young person, so someone under the age of 18, is convicted of a serious offense such as murder, they can be sentenced to life, and they are. And I know a number of people who are living under a life sentence that they got for something that that they were convicted of as a young person. And again, I have a friend who went in as a 17-year-old. And was convicted of being a party to a murder, and he has been he was well past his parole eligibility date. So young people get 10 years as their parole eligibility date, or 7 years, 7 years and 10 years, and in some cases, and so they will be eligible a little bit earlier, but in this case, and a number of cases, because of the experience that they will have often as a young person going into to an adult prison and developing, a way to survive and to be safe in there and to cope in there, he developed addictions from being in prison that he didn't have when he was in the community, and that affected his ability to affected his ability to be released. And he spent well after his eligibility in prison. He subsequently, and again, these are friends of mine, has come out and been doing well, but again, done these kind of very minor things that are things that I can do lawfully, but that he can't. And he has been returned to prison a couple of times as a result of that. So again, someone that went in as a young person. And, are we okay as a society with punishing people for life for something they do as a young person? And we know that brain development is the prefrontal cortex isn't fully developed till people are 25 years old. There, it's well understood that people's decision making is is very it doesn't contemplate long-term consequences and there's also all kinds of reasons why we might treat young people differently. And again, I'm not conceding that life sentences are okay for anyone, but I think there's particular reasons why we should be alarmed and horrified in many ways that we're imposing these sentences on young people. I mentioned that he was a party to that offense. I meant that he wasn't the person who committed, he was the actual person who actually pulled the trigger or was the main so-called perpetrator. He was involved in another way, and in our law we treat people who are parties as the same in terms of the same conviction, and normally you would impose a lesser sentence, but with murder you can't, because murder is a mandatory sentence. And and that's why I think we need to include murder and getting rid of the mandatory sentence of life for murder as a part of any project of abolishing mandatory minimums. It is the worst and most harmful, in my view, mandatory minimum sentence, in the sense that it follows people for their entire life. I guess another thing that I had meant to talk about too is that, and this is something I've written about with my colleague Emma Cunliffe, is wrongful convictions. Right. And people who are serving life sentences, who are wrongfully convicted, whether we have recognized that yet or not, or who have a claim to that, and the real difficulty of actually having convictions reviewed. We actually are fortunate to have a new report by Justice Harry LaForme and Justice Juanita Westmoreland Traore, advocating for a much more robust and better system of holding our system, even just like accountable at a basic level, to not be to provide mechanisms for reviewing whether convictions are even based in law and fact, according to our system. And I think that this is what I've been kind of wrestling with as someone who's an abolitionist and who's concerned about thinking about why are we so committed to a punishment-based system, and how does even thinking about wrongful convictions fit within that? And I think that we, as if we are looking at wrongful convictions, we can do so in a way, or people who might have a claim to wrongful conviction, whether we have yet considered it a wrongful conviction or not, is that there's a lot of similarities between people who are so-called rightfully and wrongfully convicted, in the sense of the way that our society insists on punishment and targets certain people and certain has certain assumptions that mean that people are more likely to be not believed, who are more likely to be surveilled, and to think about our work on wrongful convictions as part of a broader concern about incarceration and punishment.
I think a lot about the role that many people play in the trajectory of justice in this country, including the role of criminal defense, the role of crowns, the role of judges, and for some of the folks that I've met who have been convicted of murder, perhaps if there had been a better understanding of their circumstances or colonization, then the sentence of murder may have actually been a manslaughter sentence. And that would not have come with a mandatory life sentence. And so, I think that we all, all of us in the legal system need to really think about the different roles and the different ways that we contribute to people getting sentenced to these life sentences.
Yeah, that's a really good point. And the point about murder and manslaughter and the mandatory sentence is something that that we often don't think about, the impact of one of the most important things that the mandatory life sentence for murder does is give incredible bargaining power to Crown attorneys, in the sense that it is like, if you have a mandatory life sentence hanging over you, if you have a defense, you have self-defense, you have available, you have other defenses available to you, you claim your innocence, and you have a good, you have good legal arguments for that and factual arguments. But the fact that that if a jury or a judge will convict you despite that evidence, and maybe you don't get the best defense, and some people are less likely to get a good defense than others who can afford, who can afford it. And I have lots of, I know that defense counsel work very hard and all of that, but the reality is that there are also ways in which we make assumptions too. And it's hard to sometimes even get underneath those and to really hear the story that someone is telling us, and to be able to, with confidence, put that forward in a way
that even have the time, right? I mean, legally
have the time.
Legal aid lawyers who are defense often are paid very little for very few hours. Having done it briefly in my career, I can tell you that I spent many pro bono hours doing the work to try to understand the person that I was representing. But you just can't do that for everyone, and people don't, right? So they end up not getting the full story, not understanding the full person.
And when the crown holds, when crown holds the trump card of saying, well, you can roll the dice and go to trial, and you might get convicted, you get the life sentence. Why don't you take this manslaughter, even though you might be innocent, right? And that's one of the things that Justice Lynn Ratushny found in her review of the self-defense review after a case called Lavallee was decided in 1990. This review was held in the later 1990s, where it was a case that decided that our law of self-defense had been fundamentally sexist in its understanding of what would constitute self-defense, and didn't include and didn't contemplate the experience of someone, in many cases a woman who is experiencing abuse at the hands of a partner, an intimate partner, and how she might be acting in self-defense in ways that didn't fit the paradigm of the two men and the uplifted knife in a fight, and that self-defense looks different. And so the Supreme Court recognized that. And so then we had this review where Justice Ratushny looked at cases involving many women who had been convicted. And she recognized in her review that one of the main problems and the source of these women getting life or getting long sentences for manslaughter, or in some cases life sentences as well for murder, was that the bargaining power that the mandatory life sentence gives to Crown attorneys in these cases, and how irresistible it is sometimes to take a plea to even offense, you know, when you are innocent, and when you have a valid self-defense, because otherwise it's a mandatory life. So it has lots of distortions. So the mandatory sentence has a lot of distortions that it builds into our law as well that we need to reckon with. And for those reasons and so many others, I think I actually think it needs to be abolished. And I know not everybody will agree with me on this, but I think we really need to open up this conversation and look hard at what life sentences operate as, what they do in our society, what they don't do, what they don't bring in terms of even the kind of healing or resources for victims or families of victims. If we really care about that, and I do, I really care about the harms that people experience when they lose someone to someone else's hand, killing them, and to or in any tragic way, but particularly that our society has a role in trying to redress those harms, and a punishment-based system just simply doesn't do that, and it diverts us over to doing something very different, and then in the course of that, we destroy more lives. And I just think that it's not serving us well. So I guess in terms of looking forward, if we want to look forward to what we might
do differently. That would be great. If you could talk us through, what do you think? I mean, while we work our way toward abolishing life sentences, are there any other legislative policy or social changes, or all three?
Yeah, I think there's a lot. I mean, one very concrete one is Senator Kim Pate has had a bill before introduced in the Senate as a private member's bill. I think it may be back again, but it's been introduced a couple times, and it's the right approach as at least an interim step to allow judges to have discretion to depart from the mandatory minimum sentence in all cases, including murder. And our government has said they want to introduce some discretion and to not get rid of some of the mandatory minimums. I think this would be a way. So look up, I don't have it in front of me, but we can provide a link later to the legislative initiative to reintroduce judicial discretion to depart from a mandatory minimum sentence. So make it even a presumptive sentence that could be departed from, and that judges would have to give reasons as to why they were ordering the the minimum or not. And I think that would at least be an interim step. We should very clearly be abolishing these sentences for young people. Canada has signed on to the Conventions on the Rights of the Child. We, you know, we purport to have commitments to understand and to recognize the different place that young people are in with respect to just their brain development and just what pressures are on them and how they and the fact that they have a long future ahead of them in their lives and not to be subjecting them to these really extreme sentences. Life sentences should not be seen as normal, understandable everyday sentences. These are extreme sentences that we ought not to mete out lightly. And I think we do in Canada. And there's a way in which we have deeply normalized and internalized this idea of people's people getting a life sentence. And it's not the only way to go.
Because I think when it comes to the life sentences for young people, I have a young person in my life who is my daughter, who is 17 now. And I know people who have been convicted of a life sentence at her age. Mm-hmm. And when I think about the years of care that are left, you know, where I'm going to be caring for her and I'm going to want to have her be brought up in, you know, a loving, caring, nurturing environment. Prison is not that.
Yeah.
Prison is the opposite of that. And so if we truly are caring, you know, not just, and certainly I agree with you. I do think that life sentences need to be abolished for everyone. Mm-hmm. But it is, I think that people can quite clearly see that raising someone in a prison is mm-hmm. not the life that we want for the children of our children. So yeah. I just wanted to put a fine point on that. And I didn't mean to interrupt you. Please keep going.
No, it's, I think we need to think about what these, like, what does it mean to be, you know, to meeting out a life sentence to a young person, to anyone really. And that, you know, cause it becomes absurd when you look, you know, ahead into the future. And again, I know many people who are older and who are older than me and who are still living under life sentences, and it just becomes really absurd. And sometimes people are, you know, they're at the end of their lives and they've been out of prison for a long time, but they, you know, they are still living under all these conditions and surveillance, and it makes no sense. And it just, and I say that it makes no sense, but the sense it makes is punishment, and that we are, and so we need to like face up to that we are not a humane society if we do that, and so let's not pretend that it's something other than just kind of pure punishment. And are we okay with that? And if we're not, how can we change it? And so again, sort of interim steps that we could think about if we're not you know, I do have a horizon that is an abolitionist horizon that like kind of evaluates every kind of project and interim step as to whether it's consistent with a vision of a world without prisons, where we don't insist on that as our response to people who do harm or are convicted of doing harm in our system. And so another interim sort of step is to at least bring back the judicial review proceedings I mentioned, the so-called faint hope proceedings, that, you know, I actually think that that even at a basic constitutional level, you know, even on the terms of our own legal system, it is wildly disproportionate to not have that mechanism in there to reduce the parole ineligibility period. Again, bringing it before a jury of one's peers and, you know, ordinary people deciding whether this is still warranted, that was a moderating effect. And it actually showed that Canadians are not sort of punitive, like in the abstract or by their nature, when they actually are faced with people and are, you know, the real lived experience, they actually are much more, I think, open, you know, than and understanding than we give people credit for. It's much easier to say, you know, well, we just yeah, you did that offense and you're going to get that. And we don't care about anything that's happened. But I don't think that's actually how people operate when they actually have a chance to look someone literally in the eye and say, you know, do I still agree with this? Like, does this make sense? Is this serving anyone? At great, you know, I talk about personal costs, but you know, it, you know, and Caves knows that costs well over $150,000 to keep anybody in a federal prison for a year. For in women's prisons, it's more than that. And, you know, and it's just completely, you know, counterproductive to all of our interests to be throwing our money behind that, as opposed to allowing someone to be earning a living, paying taxes, being with their family, you know, all these other things that we see as a normal parts of our lives. I think the other thing, because that research that we've done where we saw that that people aren't getting out when they're eligible for parole, this is a big change that's happened in the last 30 years, where people used to get out within 1 year of their parole ineligibility. You know, a majority of them would. There's still some people who are going to go longer. But this means that, and again, we don't have the reasons in it. We have the data now. We have to dig in and the reasons for that. But I have some hypotheses, and I think you probably do from your work, that people aren't being prepared for release within the correctional system. There's that people who are serving life sentences often don't get access to the long correctional plan that they have to address. And they are not a priority for programming, because there's like, oh, well, they're lifers, they're going to be in here for a long time. And they often get more things added to their list that they have to complete in terms of programming. And clearly they're not being, you know, prepared for release when they're eligible. There's other research that the correctional investigator did, Ivan Zinger, before he was the correctional investigator, actually, which showed that that unless you have the support of CSC going up for parole, whatever your sentence is going up, unless you have the explicit support of CSC in going for parole, you're not going to get it. And so, and it was something like, less than 10% of people, or 5% of people who didn't have that explicit support would be successful before the parole board. So I think there's a real problem with people not being prepared and supported for going up for parole. And we don't have a system, a situation where people are more dangerous now than they were then. If anything, we know that crime rates are going down as opposed to going up. And the reality is that, you know, crime is, you know, I'll be honest, I put my cards on the table. Crime is, you know, is a social construct too. How we surveil and label and channel people into criminalization is also, you know, a whole other piece of it. But even on its own terms, the system is not working even the way it's intended to, for people to be going up before the parole board when they're eligible. And then the parole board decides. A lot of people are waiving their right to a hearing. They're not going up because I'm not going to be supported by CSC. I'm not going to go up. And so I think we need to put some pressure on corrections and on parole board to be hearing these to having people appear before them in a timely way, to making sure that people are supported. And if this needs, you know, some kind of legal action or direction, I think that may be something that we need to do. So even just getting people before the board and out when they're eligible. And then I think we really need to think about reforming, if we're not going to abolish life sentences, this perpetual punishment. We need to highlight that and let people understand that this is going on, that people are under the surveillance of corrections for something entirely unrelated to whether they're actually likely to commit another murder. They're not likely to commit another murder. They are extremely unlikely to commit another murder, or even another violent offense in the vast majority of cases. And so why on earth are we surveilling people for decades and decades and limiting what they can do? I think we should move towards a system where there's a way you can apply to be let out from under a life sentence or an indeterminate sentence. I know someone else who's we haven't even talked about indeterminate sentence for so-called dangerous offender designation. And there's just no way to have that indeterminate sentence lifted, even when you've been living successfully in the community for a very long time. And I think for people under life sentences, after they've been living successfully for a couple, 3 years, I don't see any reason why we ought to keep them under perpetual surveillance. And I think we ought to think about that as a policy change, and to talk about ways that we might challenge that and move to a system of ending a life sentence. Like it's not serving anyone at that point.
This is a lot of food for thought, and certainly I think you're going to be watching for the decision from the Supreme Court on the Bissonnette case, which is the stacking of the life sentences that you mentioned, and that's going to be interesting to see how the Supreme Court analyzes this issue, and if that will help us in any way. And then, you know, I think when it comes to parole, this is something that we have been thinking about a lot at CAFES and working towards and speaking with the parole board, speaking with CSC. I think it's a self-fulfilling prophecy, this idea that CSC wants to ensure that the people that they bring to the parole board get parole, so they won't bring people forward. And then in not bringing people forward, then people are not getting parole, right? It's this terrible cycle that is continuing. And also you bring up a good point, which is this idea that, programming needs to happen along a person's correctional plan. But if someone is serving a life sentence and has been in for a really long time, they're going to be taking these programs multiple times often, not necessarily because they need them, but because there's nothing else for them to do in prison. And even so, the efficacy of these programs, I think we should be calling into question, because we need to take a look at if someone is determined to not be fitting into what they need to in prison, it's not because necessarily they won't be able to do that on the outside. It's because it's not happening in prison, but there's no analysis of that, right? Like if somebody has perhaps anger towards being in this torturous environment of a prison, it doesn't necessarily mean that that anger is going to translate into the community, but there is very little analysis of that. And so it is something that we're working on. And I think a big part of what you've said that I think also needs to change is these conditions that people are released with. And why are we putting people on these conditions? How are they connected to the safety, public safety? How are they connected to people actually living a full life? And is there some way that we can do away with some of those ridiculous conditions that people are subjected to?
Yeah, I think that's a real place to start. And it's interesting. I teach this prison law course at UBC, and one of the things that you mentioned about, you know, the future generation of lawyers, and one of the things I take quite seriously in my role to try to have members of the legal profession, future members of the legal profession, and those who are currently kind of face up to what we actually are doing in our system, and what we have all these idealized principles, and it sounds great in theory. I don't know if it sounds great, but it sounds defensible. It sounds defensible in theory, and it fits with some of our assumptions as a society that I think we might want to revisit. But even still, what's actually going on out there and on the ground, and who the people are who are under these sentences, and what it actually looks like is actually quite different. And when you sort of face that and see that, then you have to kind of reckon with how am I going to be part of this system? And if I am, how might I work to change it? Or do I want to stand kind of, outside of it and not be part of it. Right. And so, I guess that's something for us all to kind of think about, how we want to be agents of change to the extent that we are concerned, like the different ways that we can do that. But the conditions is something. And my students, I always have people who are living under life sentences come and speak to them. Lately, it's been over Zoom, and And those are like the students' most, like the biggest learning classes that they have. They always tell me later, you know, like, I just didn't know that people were under these kinds of conditions and, you know, would be returned for, you know, for these kinds of things. And it's, like I said, it's very simple things that we can all do. And, you know, I can go over to the island if I want to visit, you know, my family. People who are living under a life sentence usually have a very limited geographical, place to be, that they have to be in. And, you know, getting permission to go outside of that is quite difficult. And, you know, and then if you find yourself, you know, on the wrong side of a condition that, you know, again, isn't about public safety, isn't necessary. They can be, returned to prison. And I know many people, as we said, who have. So this is really a place to start is, trying to change the culture and awareness around these conditions. But, you know, what I know from most of my research is that punitive laws and policies don't generally change on their own. Sometimes you might have a new policy that grows up, but we need to use all of our legal tools, and not just legal tools, but like tools for social change to try to challenge this. And so for me, that is thinking about someone who's legally trained, thinking about what are the kind of legal levers that we can use to try to challenge some of these things. And when we're bringing those kinds of cases forward or those challenges forward, doing it in a way that is not kind of not accepting the logic of the, you know, of these systems, but is saying, you know, here's how we can reduce some of the harms, and here's how we can try to actually change our laws so that we are dealing with these things in a more productive way, in a less harmful way. And so I'd love it if people would think about life sentences and really kind of examine whether we're okay with the way that they are operating and the deep sort of personal and societal costs that they are, you know, that they inflict on us, right? And to think about whether, you know, we might be able to support, you know, new approaches. And that's why, you know, in that piece I talked about starting with those questions in any kind of abolitionist vision. I don't think we should leave them to the end. I think we should start with those. And I think it kind of gets us thinking more creatively than if we simply say, well, we're still going to start with only people who commit nonviolent offenses or, you know, drug offenses or, you know, property offenses. And I think, you know, those are really harmful laws that we have around that. But I don't want to leave the life sentences to another day. I want to talk about it now. And I'm really glad that CAFES is doing that. It's so great Yes. That you're having this focus. So thank you for that.
Well, thank you to many of our staff who have driven this and really, you know, ensured that this has been something that we pay attention to. And I am grateful for that. I'm grateful for your time and your thought and the way that you framed it. And I think that this conversation that we've just had will be really helpful. Quite brilliant. Thank you so much, Deborah. And I look forward to further conversations about this as we do start to change our laws and our policies and our practices.
Thanks, Emily. Lovely to chat with you.